Well, that's a bit rude. The ad's not even finished playing yet. But I suppose that's a first. Welcome in, Spear. This doesn't go away until the ad stops playing, so buckle in. Normally I'm real quiet during this part. Normally I'm real quiet during this part because I know there's nobody here. But this time I know there's somebody watching. Somebody. So I will, I guess, stand around. Only a couple seconds left for my grand greeting. And there we are. Hello. Put a little bit high. Let's cut that thing off. Hello. 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 That away. Happy Tuesday. Welcome in. We're here. I had already started brining. I picked up a pork belly because I saw one for a good price. I'm like, grab that and do something with it. So I already started brining it, and then I got to talking last night about, oh, I should do, because it's Pride Month. Everything's rainbows. So I'm going to shamelessly cash in on that. So I was thinking, oh, I should do something specific for it. This might not be it. This might just be a half-assed last-second thing. I don't know if it's going to work at all. I was going to try slow cooking the pork belly, but now I want to make dumplings, which means I'm going to have to mince it, which means we're going to have to get it out of the brine and dry it off, because we're not going to do a slow cook. But I already split it in half, so half of it's going to get saved anyways. It was weird. There was a, I think this is why it was cheap. There was a kink, like, in the middle, where it was really, like, almost separated. So I just split it along there, and I'm brining it as a half and half, which means I can just cook half of it. So we can just use half of it, and we can use, I can say, I can keep the brine, other half in the brine now, and, gosh, rather than flap about, I will get it out. Here it is. So, normally it's one long piece. They were connected, those ends. But there was a kink right there, so I split them. And then I gave them the crosshatch cuts on the fat side. This one didn't have a lot of fat on it, so I think what we're going to do is we're going to fish this one out and use it. We're going to mince it up and we're going to use it as the as a dumpling filling. And I'm going to save that part. I'm going to slow cook that part. What's in here is just a 8-to-1 brine, simple brine solution of sugar and salt. Because I recently learned that most of the complex flavor compounds that we put into brines don't actually intrude the meat when you brine it. They just kind of get stuck on the surfaces. Very few of the molecules are small enough to get in there. Salt and sugar are, but a lot of the flavor compounds are not. So it's not really worthwhile to put them in your brine at this stage or something where you're just going to do a short brine like this. I'll do some more research and figure out which ones actually work, and then we can refine that. Really, things that I've gotten a bunch of bug bites, so I might get distracted scratching myself, which I shouldn't do. Which I shouldn't do. So this is our, and it's been, I think that's just condensation on the surface. I can't imagine this was leaking. That would be terrible. Just in case, we're going to treat that as though it is a leak. Although I don't think it's leaking, because if it was leaking, it would be dripping. And it's just kind of condensation on the surface because it's been so humid. But for the sake of safety, I will assume that that is somehow contaminated and treated as such. I've also got some shrimp thawing because I like shrimp. I was thinking of doing different flavors and color them. Do like a rainbow of dumplings. The shrimp is in this bowl over here, which I can pour some of the water off of. I believe they are properly thawed. Here they are. We're not doing too many. You should limit your intake of store-bought shrimp like that, because they are often farmed in East Asia in less than ideal circumstances. And whoa! Shining Spear has resubscribed for the 11th month. 11 months, that's almost a year. That's almost a year. Wow. 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 Let's move this meat over to the sink so that I can clean the countertop, just in case that was, in fact, the thing I said earlier. Contaminated, leaking. So bear with me for a sec while I scrub down the countertop with a little bit of a cleaner. And by a little bit of a cleaner, I mean, look, I got a jug of vinegar, and I'm going to go. Bloop. Right there. The vinegar smell is welcome in my kitchen right now. My kitchen has a very strong sulfurous unpleasantness right now. You may remember preserving the ramps, and I mentioned that most of them were good, but a couple of them around the edges weren't, so they ended up in the compost bucket. And now I've learned that ramps, when you compost them, smell strongly sulfury. So that's been fun. Every time I crack open the compost bucket, the kitchen smells like farts. Exciting. Exciting stuff. I've also been thawing out some gyoza wrappers, which are going to be my casings. They are here. And this is why I don't think I can do the rainbow colored ones, because I think if we want to do them in colors, we're going to have to make our own wrappers from scratch, which means I'm going to have to learn how to do that without breaking them, and without them being weirdly thick, which we can do, but it's a lot of work. So I didn't plan ahead for it today. So, my book woman. I'm actually going to try to put some color on the wrappers and see if they soak it in. That's the plan. We're also going to get one of our pork pieces out now. Pork belly. And seal in the other one. Welcome in. Hello. How are you? I'm fine. Okay. So the other half is going to go back in the fridge and be cooked properly in the method that I had originally planned, so it can just stay in the brine. Probably do that tomorrow. I can make a sandwich out of it. I'm gonna mince this guy up. As mentioned, pork belly was just in a very, very simple brine of salt and sugar. Which I thought was going to firm it up a little bit more than it has. Oop, there's a piece of that still on there. That right there is what they call, and that right there especially is what they call silver skin, I believe. And it is a tough membrane that animals have that holds their insides in when they're alive. And you can't really eat it. I'm gonna just cut that away a little bit. It's pretty thin. This might not actually be silver skin. Well, that piece was, but this larger one over here doesn't look like it is. This wasn't the greatest. This wasn't a discount to be an option, but it was a relatively cheap option, and I think it's because it wasn't the greatest piece of pork belly that the butcher had ever seen. It was like, okay, well, we'll mark that one down so somebody buys it. So, not discounted on account of it being short dated, discounted on account of it being a little gnarly. Which is fine. Gnarly meat is still good meat. Just takes a little bit of cleaning. Okay. That wasn't so bad. That actually was not bad at all. Just a tiny bit, and it came off pretty easily. We're going to switch to the small sharp knife to take these pieces off. So, pork belly is one of my favorite pieces. It's got a lot of flavor. It's got a lot of fat. It takes well to multiple different styles of cooking. We don't see it a lot because, especially in the US, it gets turned into bacon at an aggressive pace. It also means that it is hardly ever discounted on account of it being, on account of bacon being so popular at all the time. The first slice looks nice, but I'm going to mince this up anyway. So, the first slice was a very nice shape. This knife is a little bit sharper for the initial cuts than the big one. And since I'm going to mince it up anyways, I don't really care if it's in smaller pieces. Magra D, hi. Many things are better with bacon. This is not bacon, but many things are better with bacon. Welcome, welcome. How's it going? I should, you know what I should do? You know what I should do, since I'm going to mince this up. We're going to put both these in the sink. We're going to wash my hands real quick. I'm doing this the hard way, and I shouldn't be. There's no reason to. Because I have the tool. I have the exact tool for this job. I just have to get it. So, walk out of the room real quick. Walk over to this room. Retrieve my right tool for the job. Bring it back. This is the right tool for this job. Mincing it with a knife is foolish. Don't know why I reached for that first when this was clearly the correct choice. Food processor. Food processor can mince this up really easily. And evenly. Let's get the parts in place. Stick our pork belly in there, and if I'm doing it this way, I may as well throw my flavor compounds in there as well. Wash, wash, wash. Move the board. Move the processor for the moment. Yeah, I could already tell that was going to be a little bit tedious. We are going to cut some stuff by hand, just to make it sort of more reasonably sized pieces. Some ginger. Skin on, because don't care. So some ginger. I've just got it off to the side over here, so I'm just gonna toss stuff to that direction as I pull them out. Yeah, the things the food processor does, it does really well, and I don't reach for it as often as I think I probably should, but I do appreciate it when it is the best tool for the job, such as the garlic peeler. Which is the best tool for this job. Yeah, I know. Slowly mincing stuff. I've done it before. I spent 45 minutes mincing mushrooms once. The results of which were incredibly delicious. And that was before I had the food processor. That would have been an application for the food processor. Stick them in there and mince them up in a second. That was mushroom bolognese. That one had an extra layer of paper on it. That's a big garlic clove. Okay. Ooh, another big garlic clove. I'm going to get this one out. We're not going to put all four of these in there. We're going to put three of them in there, and we're going to save one of them for another reason, for another purpose. But this one is even bigger garlic clove. Wow. The size of this garlic clove. So I have, speaking of garlic, that can be, it's not going to be my same old thing. I'm going to say the same old thing I always say. Prep your garlic at least 10 minutes before you want to actually use it so that it has time for the alanase to react with the alanin to make the allicin, which is the flavor compound that you want from the garlic, and that's the reason you got garlic in the first place. It's the thing that you think of when you think of garlic flavor. I have relatively recently, a couple of my friends have been diagnosed as FODMAP sensitive. I don't remember what that acronym stands for. It's a dietary thing. Garlic is a big trigger, which is tragic. But I have been doing some research, and I think I can make a garlic extract that won't upset their tummies. Doing a crush with the flat of a blade. So I'm probably gonna not, obviously not today, I've got a different project in mind, but I might do that soon. One of them generously volunteered to be a guinea pig. So I'll make the thing, and then we'll see if it upsets their tummy. Just a coarse chop of that into the thing. Garlic, ginger, and the third element that goes into something like this is, of course, always scallions. But I'm throwing in. I don't think I want them to throw them in there because they'll just get pulverized. I think I want them in little circles. I do, however, have some dried shiitake mushrooms that I'm just going to break up and throw in there because I think they will soak up juices that come out of the ingredients here. This is the worst thing I could possibly do. I'm picking up one of these and I'm crushing it, but I'm doing it over here. You can't see it. Which, why am I doing that? Bring this back. Go right above you and you can. That's probably enough of those. We don't need that many. I also, just today, because my basil was trying to flower and it's much too early for that, picked some basil. So I'm going to throw that in. That's a different flavor that doesn't go with any of the rest of these. Is anything else? See, I do have a reference. I often have a reference. I have two references. I've got one for pork and one for shrimp. It wants soy sauce, rice wine, salt, spice powders, and a little bit of chicken stock. And some green onion, which I can, fine, I will. Again, doing something that you can't even see off the side. I'm mincing up a green onion. We're going to throw some of it in there. I don't know why I'm mincing it so finely. I just instinctually want to. It's going to get pulsed in the thing. So we'll throw that in there. We've already got basil in there, which is an odd thing. We're not going for the flavor combo that this recipe says. So I'm not reaching for the Chinese five spice. I'll give it... little bonus garlic powder. I'll give it. Actually, have five spice here. What goes in five spice? Cinnamon, anise, ginger, nutmeg, and clove. There's already ginger in there. We can add. We could add some nutmeg. I don't think I want to add some nutmeg. We can add some MSG and some salt to it, however. There's already some salt in it because I brined it, so don't go overboard. I think I may have gone overboard. It doesn't need to be ground to a pulp either. I'm going to give it a little bit of mirin. Mirin. In part to help lubricate, in part for flavor. And then I guess we will give this thing a go. It's hard to see once I've got the lid on. Power. Ugh, you can't even see the buttons if I push it back. Angle's wrong. I guess it's better to look in the top then. We're gonna pulse it a couple times. Ooh, we're gonna hold it down. Going for a paste, we're going for more like a grind. Which I think we're getting. What do you think? Ooh, it smells good. Ooh, it smells really good. Some of the mushrooms stayed stuck on the blade. I don't want to go any further than this, I think, because otherwise we'll end up with more of a meat paste than a grind. So, power off so I don't accidentally cut my hands up. It smells good. We got to get that out of there into this bowl. This was the bowl that was going to be catching it. Anyways, I appreciate the suction cups on the food processor for when it's running, but they're a little bit annoying for when I want to get it off the counter. take our blade out. Don't cut yourself. When I first got this thing out of the package and was cleaning it for its pre-use initial wash, I cut myself. Not this attachment, the disc attachment. And let me tell you, those blades are redonkulously sharp. It's just so sharp. Which is good for the cooking part of it, but dangerous for the washing part of it. Okay. That was much better and easier than doing it with a knife. It's more even, it's more consistent, it's finer than I think I would get it with a knife, and it was also a ton faster. Do think it needs a little bit of lubrication still. So, gonna give it a splash of soy sauce and a splash of, that soy sauce is almost empty. Where are you? There you are. A splash of sake. We're going to stir that in. With our hands, with our fingers. Yeah, feels like a meat mince. A little bit looser, a little bit chunkier than I think you'd get out of a pre-made one, a pre-packaged one, but similar in texture, which is exactly what I was hoping for. Okay, looks good. That looks excellent. Not just good, excellent. Wash up my hands. We're gonna wash up the board, not the board that's over there, the nylon board. I'm gonna wash the nylon board real quick because I want to do the shrimp, and I'm not gonna throw the shrimp in the processor. Shrimp is a little bit more delicate. And also I would have to fully clean out the processor. Would I have to fully clean it? I probably wouldn't have to fully clean it out. Well, since I'm gonna be cooking all this stuff anyways. Left you guys looking at nothing, at some mince. The nylon board with our shrimps, which need to be shelled. Save your shells. Always save thine shells. They're full of flavor. Oh, too late now. Next time. As I said in the title, this is practice, so I think we're going to come back to this not too much down the line. I've got enough shells to make stock. I could make a shrimp stock and have that be a liquid component to add to our fillings to make them a little bit softer. Or we could try soup dumplings with shrimp stock. That might be fun. That might be too much fun. That might be excessive. Stop me. Stop me before I go too far. Gonna have to have a party where I make soup dumplings. Shellfish. Still wash your hands, but it is less urgent than animal meat. They spoil faster, but they don't typically harbor the same types of pathogens in their unspoiled state. Definitely always still wash your hands. But I'm a little bit less concerned. Most of the things you're worried about getting from seafood are, in fact, parasites rather than bacteria. That's why I would never eat like a raw chicken sushi, for example. Calling out all you raw chicken sushi people who are currently watching me. Or watching on the VOD. Hello, people on the VOD. Hello, that one person who watches my VODs. Somebody watches the VODs because there's one view on a couple different videos. See, shrimp is much... a much more delicate meat, so I feel like throwing it in the food processor would just pulverize it. Doing this with a knife is already giving us a very soft texture. So I don't want to go any further than that with it. Okay. Clean stuff up a little bit. Handle all this raw goop with my fingers. Raw chicken sushi. That's a thing. I didn't come up with that. That is a thing. That is a thing that people do. And the government of Japan has said, please don't do that. And boy, that sure hasn't stopped people. Boy, that sure hasn't stopped people. I suppose it's not that much difference from the raw hamburger sandwiches that we have around my neck of the woods. Shrimp is a little needs a little bit of extra fat in it to make it work as a dumpling filling. So, what have I got right here? Fatty pork. Combo. Welcome in, Swiftzer. Is this good dumplings? I don't know if this is good dumplings. It might be. If we're lucky, it will be. If we're not, it won't be. I'm definitely going to give it a try. We're going to flavor this one a little bit differently. On this side, pinch extra salt. So far, it's not, but it might be. Like I said, I'm practicing. Dumpling practice. So we've got our so far we've got a pork mince. It's pork minced pork belly with a bunch of spices and flavors in it. And I just minced up some shrimp, and I've added a couple of scoops of that to this to give it a little bit of a fatty base to work with. Because otherwise, shrimp is very lean by comparison to pork. If you were doing this with chicken, I would suggest doing it with thighs because you want the bit of the fattiness. I've actually got a shrimp recipe reference pulled up. I can check. Oop, I just closed it instead of checking it. I guess I don't have one pulled up. But welcome in. It's not my first time ever making dumplings, but I have only made dumplings, I think, once or twice before. Not often. I've had a bad time in the past trying to get them to look nice. They're very, very, they're very lumpy and kind of ugly in the past. That can stay. And I have not made my own wrappers, which I think is the next step in my development would be making my own dumpling wrappers. Especially since I wanted to try getting colors on them. I'm gonna pull one out and see how it works if I try to colorize it. Whenever I wash my hands, I can't see the chat. Don't be sad. Don't be sad. This is a happy time. I get to make delicious food. This is one of my favorite things ever, making delicious food. My steamer. Where did I put that? I haven't used that since the last time I made dumplings. This guy. And he fits quite nicely into one of the steel pots, but we have to do our work in batches. Unless I've got a new. I didn't have this one last time I made. I didn't have this one last time I made them. Last time I tried them. The steamer basket is meant to fit any container, and it actually this is the max size for it, so we could probably get more of them in here. But does the lid fit? Because that little post in the center might be too tall, might be a not lid fit situation. Ooh. I can't unscrew it. Oh, I can unscrew it. Perfect. We just have to not lose the little handle. Okay. We're going to put some water in there and get it steamy. Not going to get it steamy right away. We're going to get the right amount of water in there, and then I can steam it up later. I just don't want the water to ride over the edge of the the base of the steam basket. So 2 cups of water is actually just about right for that. Okay. That guy can now just sit there, and I will move back over and attempt the next thing. Here we go. So I bought prepackaged gyoza. They were frozen, so we'll see how they are once I get them out of here. I know I should definitely make these myself at some point. That's like a key thing. Wow, this is a tight seal. Okay. Get out of there. Gyoza, the ones, they're pretty small. They're pretty small. But that's fine. So what I wanted to try was coloring one. Or possibly two at a time with food dye. This is where making my own would be much, much easier. I need just tiniest amount of water. And a drop of blue. And do that. Oh, okay. It might not work because it might break them apart. It's blue, but it's also split on me. Fold that guy up. I'm gonna get blue on all of them. This might be a foolish endeavor. This might be a foolish endeavor. I am not going to try to force this through like this because that one I don't think worked. I don't think that worked. This is nice and blue, but I think wetting the entire thing like that is a disaster waiting to happen. So we are giving up, and I will attempt to put colors in. You have to wet them, but you don't wet the whole thing. You don't want to wet the backside. You want to wet the edge so it can seal. So what happened there when it broke, it was sticking to the surface it was on. Because when you wet it, it becomes sticky so that it will stick to itself so that you can seal it. But that one was sticking to the board. So I couldn't effectively pull it together. So you're right, I need water. But just the tiniest, tiniest, tiniest bit. So I've got a little dish of water now. And we're gonna have to move the food processor base out of the way. And get a. Oh, we should cut out a sheet of parchment for the. Sheet pan is going to be resting on the side out of sight. I shouldn't use parchment for this. I should just do wax paper. Well, I'll use that parchment to cut out the shape for the thing. But I've got just wax paper in here, and this is the ideal situation for wax paper because this isn't being cooked. It just needs to not stick. So, wax paper. Okay, so a wax papered sheet pan on the side so that when I form these, they can. Okay. And then you're supposed to take it to the middle and then go crimp, crimp. That didn't work. Get down in there. Little bundles. No, there's air spaces in there. There's plenty of, there was the right amount of filling. There's just air spaces in there that the filling should be getting into. I just didn't do it very well. This part takes practice for sure. This is the part where we need to practice it. And there are other shapes that are easier. Okay. Because I could fold it like a ravioli. But you're supposed to get the stuff is supposed to stay kind of centered. And then you fold up and you go crimp, 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 and crimp. That one looks pretty good, honestly. It's not the, what, 21 tiny folds of the like traditional shape. But yeah, you can, I mean the shape on the package are these little like pot sticker guys. Because you can just go. Fold up to the middle. Pinch them down the sides. And that is a viable shape. But that doesn't have a flat bottom. So then you have to like pinch the edge along to get the bottom to be flat so that you can flat bottom it. And I'm not good at those either. That one looks pretty good. And having a little air pocket in the top helps to ensure that it won't burst when we're cooking it. I'm trying shapes. And they have to be small enough that they will cook through in the steam, in the steamer, since all of the ingredients in the middle are raw. Oops. Oh, how do I do that? Like that. And like that. Okay. We have an ad coming up for those of you who are actually watching this. This is a little bit tedious. I'm not gonna lie. I'm not a master at this. I did say this is practice because we are definitely having to practice here to get this. Okay, I like reasonably like that shape. I reasonably like that shape. It would be less tedious, and also, if I had minced the pork by hand, I would still have to do this. So that would have been two tedious things. I think this will go a little bit faster as I develop a method. That one, now that one I overfilled for sure. 100%. That one we overfilled. See, if I made my own dough, I could customize the size, and then I wouldn't be restricted by what is available in the store. See, now that one I'm really happy with. And I even think that one's slightly overfilled. I'm just pleased with the nice, even star five-pointed fold. The last time I made dumplings, it has been a while. The last time I made dumplings was for a Halloween thing, where I made pumpkin spiced dumplings. Which had pork, pumpkin spice, and yes, I put pumpkin in them. The pumpkin itself got kind of lost, but the flavors of those spices go really well with meat. They are very, very similar to what's in the Chinese five spice mix. They're almost identical to what's in the Chinese five spice, your standard Chinese five spice blend. Oh, I got out a tray on the side so that I could put those there rather than have them take up space on the board here. The pumpkin spice dumplings were very tasty. The pumpkin did add quite a lot of extra moisture that then kind of made the finished things shrivel up a little. Let me move. Okay, I think we've developed a method, and I'm getting a little bit more consistent with it. Think we've developed a method, and I'm getting a little bit more consistent with it as I go, which is very, very much what I was hoping was going to happen, which is why I titled this Practice. I have heard from those of Chinese descent that it is a popular thing to do with your grandparents or your mother or something, folding dumplings as like a family activity. Because it's a bit time consuming, but then there's a delicious end result. Welcome back from the ad, anyone who was on the ad. Appreciate you sticking through the ad if you did, in fact, see one. If you didn't, I appreciate you subscribing so that you don't see ads. This is not how I folded the pumpkin ones. The pumpkin ones I folded much like pot stickers, crimped them along, folded them in half, and then crimped them along the seam. So this is an entirely new thing. This is more the what I think of as the Chinese style, where they're in circles, and then there's a little gap in the top. If you make soup dumplings, they are this approximately this shape, although they're made with many more small crimps. But they leave a little gap in the top because the soup, well, that one was very overfilled, because the soup would otherwise explode them. So no, this is not this. I've not done this before. This method that I'm doing is completely. You are watching me learn it in real time. I also don't have any sort of guide up for how to do this. I'm just feeling what seems, doing what feels right, feeling what does. I'm doing what I think feels like is the best way. In this case, we've got a much more traditional filling, but I do need to, this is something that I should know how to do and can do quickly. Because like that, it's very pretty. I like the little five petaled design. There is a little bit of buildup of the flour from the surfaces of the wrappers getting on my hands and making them slightly gummy. Now, so every once in a while, I'm going to rinse my hands out. We have our last little scooper of the shrimp mix, which is too small. So I'm going to give it a little extra scooper of our pork mix so that it can too be too big, like all the other ones. But yeah, dumplings are a thing that pretty much every culture around the world, near as I can tell, has created independently. They don't all look exactly the same, but they are all in a very similar culinary space of a filling wrapped in a starchy container, and then often boiled or steamed, occasionally fried, but many of them are boiled and steamed. Pierogies, raviolis, dumplings, gyoza. Tamales. Tamales are essentially this as well. I'm getting better at them. I'm definitely getting better at it as I go. Hopefully I build up some muscle memory and I can just crank these out. Bao. Yep. Bao is another one. It seems like it might be the perfect food because every culture has gravitated towards this thing in its most basic form. So there, I've said it. Dumplings and all of their global variations are the perfect food. Hot take. Hot take for the day. Dumplings, perfect food. I suppose you could even do one of these like a ravioli where you fill the middle and then put a second wrapper on top and pinch around the edge. You do that with raviolis in part because the that type of dough doesn't stick to itself the way this type of dough does. So you have to give it a crimp to get it to hold. And if you're doing a crimp, you may as well then just do two layers. I'm not saying Italian dough doesn't stick to itself, but it doesn't adhere the way this stuff does. Boy, I've got this one guy is really kind of sticking out in my tray over here. So what are you guys having for your meals, your dinner, or lunch, or breakfast, or midnight snack, or whatever Whatever you're doing. I'll be having these, and there'll be enough left over to have them again, I think. Oh, this guy is before I go overboard. That one is overfilled. We're gonna take a little bit of the filling out of that one. That one was overfilled to the point where I don't think I could close it. Getting a little zealous with my fills here. And it's also time to rinse my hand off again. I didn't make them look any different, despite my assertion of attempting rainbow. As soon as that failed, I haven't even tried to make these things look different from each other. Jen, for 9 months, that's a Twitch baby. Mazel tov. How's it going? What's up? Welcome in. I'm practicing folding dumplings and frequently overfilling them, but that's fine. Keeb stuff, I don't know what that means. I might be too old. And then a concert, and then a concert. Very exciting, very exciting. Well, I appreciate you sticking your nose in around these parts. I'll be here. Hopefully, I can get these guys started before you have to run off so you can see what they look like when they are cooked. If not, glad to see you anyways. What's your experience with dumplings? I've been trying to steer the conversation around dumplings. Just glad to be here, Bob. We have a Chinese-inspired pork filling, which I'm working through now, and the ones we did at the beginning were a shrimp filling. And I was going to colorize them and try to make rainbow dumplings, but since I'm using pre-made skins, it was not looking like it was going to be very effective, so I abandoned it before I ruined a bunch of skins. We will, since I think I've got a pretty good method on the fold, we will revisit this soonsh. We'll revisit this sometime in the near time. I'll make my own dough and then I can actually colorize them for Pride Month. Since especially this year, it seems we really have to double down on Pride Month because the anti-Pride Month people are ravening hordes. But yeah, I tried putting some dye on these and it just wasn't working. It made it blue. I already threw the blue one away. It made it blue, but it made the entire thing go sticky immediately, and I was no way I was going to be able to fold them into dumpling shapes. With them that sticky. So we had to nix that. I might try to get some color in after folding. But either way, today the core intent of today was to practice making these things. Interesting idea. I've got a little bit of blue water left over here. I will try this one. I will try this exact one that I've started here with the blue water. I didn't actually throw the blue water away. We'll see what it does. We'll see what it does. I have just done a whole bunch of them, so if this works, then I'll be like, oh, I should have done this the whole time. Take a scooper, take a little bit back because that was too much. I'm also learning to eyeball how much filling is the right amount for these things so they don't refuse to seal. Okay. Well, it's a little blue. And now we fold. Well, it's faintly blue. Yeah, at the start I was really trying different shapes. Here, I'll show you. I've settled on this five-petaled fold because it has been working and it's pretty fast to do. But I did one of these. Oops. I did one of these, which came out okay, but is a little bit uneven. I did one of these where I just kind of pinched it all together into a parcel. And while I was working on my five-pointed thing, I made this mess. The five-pointed ones are the most of them. They aren't all perfectly even, but I'm getting more consistent as I go. I'm getting more consistent with them as I go. So this is definitely working in terms of practice. I'm not sure that the blue water is worth it because the effect on the final stuff is very faint. And then I've got blue on my hands. But yeah, I didn't look up any guides for this. I'm just winging it. And I think I've settled on a pretty overfilled, pretty effective one that has a nice finished look to it and isn't too hard. Like the ones with the 21 crimps or however many perfect number of crimps, they look very nice, but they're difficult to make. Which is the point. A lot of times those things are difficult because the purpose of them was to be difficult. The French do that a lot. Why do you do it this way? Because it's hard. A lot of old, like very old, like Renaissance, French recipes specifically include a garnish, a decorative garnish on the plate made out of puff pastry. Because when it was all made by hand, puff pastry was very difficult to make. So it was literally there to show off the skill of the chef, who also didn't make it himself. So it was there to show off the skills of the chef in terms of having a kitchen staff who could make the damn thing. And it was just decorative. It didn't taste like anything. It was unflavored. It was usually cut into a shape, so just a little piece. But it was puff pastry because it had to be made by hand. And making puff pastry by hand is so labor intensive and can go wrong so easily. Now you run across those old recipes and it has this on there, and you're like, why is this here? Well, that's why it was there. Simply because it was difficult for the chefs to make. So it was a flex. And then it became tradition. And now we can do it whenever, because you can buy pre-made puff pastry and just crescent stamp a thing out of it and be done. Brioche the same way. You made it by hand once. I've never made my own full French style puff pastry, on account of it being easy to buy and not very expensive, and so easy to mess up. Phyllo. Phyllo's another one like that. I would never make phyllo by hand. Never. Once upon a time, it was a huge flex to serve phyllo because of how difficult it is to make. Now, it can be made by a machine. So you can make the things, and they're good. The things that like it's unique. It's definitely a unique thing, but it's less amazing in the era of, oh yeah, a machine can do that because it. Choux is one you can make at home. Yeah, choux is one that I think I could manage. Let's do this last one a different shape because I got an extra large blob. But it's not big enough to split into two blobs. So we're going to take all my remaining filling and make one extra large one in a different shape. Well, I read around your typo, so if you hadn't called it out, I wouldn't even have noticed. Let's I kind of want to make a ravioli out of this one. You know? Like, squish the stuff down into a puck. Grab one of these guys, slap it on top, and ravioli the edges just to see what it does. You know, why not? Just to see what it do. And then we could even pinch up the sides. There, one weird one. One big weird one, just to be weird. Why not? Okay, wash our hands, this time with soap. I was just rinsing my hands periodically before to get the buildup off of them. But this time with soap. And a towel. The remaining dumpling wrappers are going to have to get bagged. It might. That one might turn out the best of all. I should do experiments, really. I settled on the five petaled one because they were so easy to just do. I don't know if they're going to be the best in terms of actual, like, result. Let's get that guy over here. And this guy. That one's going to have to get washed because I'm going to want to use it immediately. A little bit, in just a moment. So we're going to wash it. It will dry readily. Should dry readily. Is that knife over there? No, the knife is over here. Good thing about the wooden board is that it dries quite a bit faster than the plastic boards. I'm sure because some of the moisture gets pulled into the wood, but also because the wood is porous, so there's some air coming out at the moisture. Okay. The knife and the board are done. Ooh, I left you looking at the glaring. So the water's already in here, but I need to get some parchment on it. And I rolled out this big sheet intending for the tray, which I suppose can now be brought up. This is how many we made. This is how many of these things we made. We've got one big weird one there. We got this scrimped, squiggly one here. Lots of nice little five-fives. That guy's a pale blue dot. That's our pale blue dot. I've lost track of which ones are which, except that the shrimpy ones are more on this side and the porky ones are more on that side, because I sort of filled the tray from that direction. And a couple of ugly ones where I was still getting a feel for the process. But we need to put a sheet of parchment over here on my steam rack, because those will stick to the steam rack in an instant. And I should be smart about this, not dumb about this. Okay. You're not going to be able to see. I'll be over here. I have to dry off the table. I think we're going to do two batches. I think we're going to do two batches because I have more. Oh, I got blue on my countertop. That's not what I wanted to have happen. That's never going to come off. I have more there than can fit in one go, but I think we'll be able to get them in two. Because I'm using the wider, shallower pan. Oop, back over here. Since the lid is the right size, we're going to use the lid as the guide for cutting this into an appropriately sized sheet. This is a case where I wish I had one of those bamboo steamers. Those things are so neat. I don't, so I just have to keep wishing, but. Uh, And it doesn't need to be perfect. It actually doesn't even need to be a circle, because you can just sort of make it into an octagon by taking the corners off. Octagon. Bring that over here. Plunk it in the thing and heat on. Ah, yeah, Throne. I have heard of Throne. I have not looked into it, and my understanding, it is something I should set up, but I'm hesitant at this stage of my development, where I'm getting like a handful of people watching. I'm hesitant to jump in on things like, here's a Patreon, here's a Ko-fi, here's a Throne, give me money. Type stuff. I'm a little hesitant on that. But I should probably at least set up an account there so I could throw some wish list thing on it, like a bamboo steamer or a camera to replace this one or a ring light or a ring light. But yeah, I've heard of that. Jim has been using Throne for his Legos, which I also thought was a great idea because Legos are very expensive. But yes, good idea. I'll have to write that down to remind myself to go actually just create the account. And now what we're going to do is just boil the water that's underneath the steamer basket so that we can make that thing filled with steam. And then we're going to steam these, which means I should make dipping sauce. Bookwoman, you said I could try rainbow sauces. I did not forget that. Trouble is the sauces are going to sort of verge to brown naturally. Going to verge to brown naturally because they're going to have some brown ingredients in them. So I got to think, how could I make sauces that aren't just full of brown so that you could see colors that I put in them? Can't reach for soy sauce. I've got a stack of these little. I've got a stack of these. So this could be our thing. I don't know if I want to do six sauce variations. Ooh, actually, better than this. I have a fresh one. Where did you go? Fresh citrus. Fresh citrus. So. Roll your lime to break up the little juicy bits. Grab your board that is reasonably dry already. Board dries off quite quickly. So we can have a citrus-based sauce. Oh, I got a seedless lime. That's nice. Okay, I was going to try to squeeze it with my hand, but I think we're going to need the reamer to really get the juice out. But we're going to try to be careful and not get a bunch of pulp in there. Okay. We might not do all six. Six might be too much. We might shoot for four. Okay, two with lime juice. Things that are light in color, so they don't all just go brown on me. We want a sweet one. We probably want a sweet one. So pull these down. If I add a little bit of honey to one of my limes, salt, 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 salt. They all want salt. Licking the salt on my fingers. There's steam escaping. You can see it here, which means I can hear the bubbling. Which means it's steamy in there. How long do you steam these things for? That's something I need to definitely check. So, 8 to 10 minutes as a not steamed option. Put the big guy in there. Might be three batches. Looking more like three batches. Lid on. They can steam away while I think about sauces. Everybody's got a little bit of salt. If I put some smoked paprika on this side, with a dash of rice vinegar and a dash of water. I wish I had something purple that I could juice. Don't be stuck. We have something red. banana ketchup is a dark red compared to the other one. And if I add a drop of my blue, and then we just have to get the flavors going. Blue. Red. Yellow. Green. We've gone with food coloring. This one needs a little bit more liquid in it. Do I still have that corn syrup? I do. Light corn syrup has no color and will give us a little bit of sweetness in our red option. The tomato's giving us, or not tomato, the ketchup's giving us red in that one and some sweetness. So they've all got salt. They don't all have a good amount of acid in them. We're going to give purple a little bit of this, which is a balsamic reduction glazy thing. We also need some just spices in these guys. They're very, very nothing right now. Grab this one. Nope. Sometimes pushing the thing into the blade works better than pulling the blade through the thing. So teeny tiny scallion rings in our green one. Sesame oil in our yellow one. Stir them around and see what they look like. Well, they look red and yellow and green. The green one's just lime juice and scallions, I think. Excuse me. Yeah, the green one's just lime juice and scallions, so that one needs something else in there. Oh, and this one... isn't coming out purple, it's coming out kind of black. And now it's coming out a little bit brown. Let's add a dash of water to it, see what it does. Well, that's an appetizing color. It's gone kind of a midnight green on me. The one that just lime juice needs sugar and water. And that one needs some water too. I can smell the dumplings. I didn't set a timer. How long they've been in there, guys? Any idea? I gotta taste these. Lime. That one's tasty. That one's punchy. That one's sweet. We're gonna give you some sesame seeds, you some sesame seeds. We're going to throw some scallion rings in the yellow one. With a dash of garlic there and there and there. Spicy chicken sauce. Get some spicy chicken sauce in that one. Red one's gonna be an angry one. Well, this one, the color has not worked for sure. I kind of want to break up the horrible blackness with the white sesame seeds. So it's not horrible blackness. I've forgotten how long the dumplings were in there. So we are going to assume they're done and start retrieving. I can smell them, which is a good sign. We can actually do a test on them. Since there's a top, little open top bit, I can give them a poke. Yeah, okay, they're hot to the middle, so they definitely just need to come out. Bamboo tongs are the perfect situation for here. I will say the blue one, the blue one got more blue when I steamed it. So coloring the water used for sealing them might actually be a solution. It was very understated when it was fresh, but it's more distinctly blue. I don't know if it's showing on the camera very well, but it's more distinctly blue to my viewing eye than when it was uncooked. So potential. That's a potential. We are going to have one more batch, but it's going to be a small batch because I got a lot of them in here without that big weird one in the middle. Lid on. Back to our sauces, where I'm going to add white sesame seeds to that one and that one and that one. I know, I'm just kind of playing right now with these things. Feel like okay, well, added too much of that already. Because it got clumpy on me. We're just adding stuff. We're just kind of throwing stuff at the wall here. Making these in such small quantities is probably not really very good for them either. This calls for a tiny whisking. Oh, that's gone to a terrible shade of puke brown. That's not what you wanted to see. I need a rinse for the whisk. Don't know about this, yeah, the camera makes it look black, but I can see it in my personal eyes. Okay, taste. Green one. Tastes a lot like lime juice. Yellow one. Tastes a lot like sesame oil. Red one. Ugh. Whoa. It's spicy and sour. It's actually tasty, but it's definitely the strongest one so far. Weird one. It's tasty. That one's tasty. It doesn't look very good, but it tastes good. I feel as though colored sauces isn't working very well. But too late to back off now. Let's throw some mayonnaise in the green one. What do you mean, oh well? Now it's light green. Tastes a tiny bit better. Otherwise, that one just tasted like lime juice. I kind of want to combine this one and that one. Yeah, I'm not sure about this whole what I've started here. This part might be a write-off. What have I got? What have I got? What have I got? Let's just add stuff. Ugh. I should have used this as my purple one's starter. Because this is naturally purple. Because it's made out of boysenberries. I didn't look at the time again. What do you think? Are those dumplings ready for the next one? Well, we can always check. There's literally only four left on the over here. Pick the fattest one. Poke right to the middle. Check the temperature. Yep, it's done. I need another plate catch them. The dumplings look great. The sauces I'm not a big fan of. The dumplings look great. Long as I don't mangle them by trying to get them out of here with these bamboo tongs. They look a lot better than the last time I tried making dumplings. They haven't really shriveled up. The having this petal shape, I think, has helped them kind of fold into themselves instead of getting all wrinkly. So that's good. So that's good. I don't hear bubbling anymore. I think we might have run out of water. Which wouldn't be ideal. We definitely ran out of water, which isn't ideal. I hope I didn't scorch my pan. I think I had my heat on too high. That's not ideal. That's not ideal. You're going to have to get some more water in that pan. A proper amount of water in that pan because it is on the verge of scorching. Okay. Well, that wasn't ideal. I should have put more water into it when I took the first batch out. Hopefully I have not harmed my pan at all. I've only got a couple left. I'm gonna turn the heat down a little bit. Hopefully I haven't hurt the pan. We will find out in a bit, but I guess for those of you following along at home, and I know you are, be sure to turn your heat down a bit and check your pan for water. You do not want the pan at the bottom to dry out. The sauces over here have gone weird. The ugliest looking one is the tastiest. And two of them are green. I'm not going to eat just yet because there are still four of them in there. We're going to steam those off and then I will eat. Also, there's an ad running right now. So give me 10-ish minutes. 8-ish minutes. 8-ish minutes. Although I can start assembling a plate while we wait for those last ones to steam. I tell you, having the hole in the top where I can insert a probe to check for doneness is super helpful. Let's use this plate. I just picked this plate up. I don't think I've used it for the show yet. You know what I'm gonna do? You know what I'm gonna do? I'm not going to do what I was just about to do. We're going to get the weird ones in the middle. And kind of bury them, including this blue one. You know, that big one actually doesn't look that problematic. I thought the big one was going to be go weird on me for sure, but it has not does not appear to have done so. Fill that hole with one of the ones that's still steaming. The sauces have not worked out. When we revisit this, I'm going to make my own dough, my own wrappers, and then I can colorize those. Like I said, this is practice. Practice means we're going to come back to it. And unlike every other time I say I'm going to come back to something, we're actually going to come back to this one. I'm going to take a picture with the sauces. I'm tempted to put sauce on top of them so there can be like little drizzles of color. Okay. Scallions make the plate look nicer. I dot E dot the thought counts. I think you slipped off the space bar and onto the dot there. These two are, well, that guy got dust on him. Guess I'll wash all of You know what would be good? And I might actually come back and try making soup dumplings because I picked up these things, which are not the right shape to be like soup spoon, but they are the right shape to be used for soup dumplings because you can fit one of these guys right in the thing perfectly. What do you think? Shall we temperature test our final batch here? Yep, we're definitely cooked to the middle. They cook real quick. They cook faster than I think the directions indicate. The directions probably indicate for safety, but honestly, these are cooking lickety split. And I think I've hidden all of the ugly ones. And then we can put my one weird pinched guy right on the top. To be proud of the differences that actually are like intentional differences instead of oops. Let me go take a picture and then I'll come back and we can taste these and I'll tell you how I did. Oops. Ever since I plugged in my air conditioner. My outlet has short, or is. I'm short an outlet. And I have to keep swapping between my microwave and my light. It's interesting that the black sauce here is the tastiest one, and the least appealing looking. Oh, where did I put my? Oh, yeah, right. Of course. Of course. Of course. Bear with me, guys. Bear with me. Bear with me. Cheetah with me. Other animals. Alligator with me. Plate not, it might not have been exactly the right choice. They are very similar in color to the color of the plate, but I like the way that they break up the lines. Okay, coming back with the sauces. With the sauces, because we've got to taste these sauces as well. With the actual dumplings, not just by themselves, because sauces are meant. Many sauces don't taste good. By themselves. They only taste good when you combine them with the thing they're meant to be with. They're enhancers. Okay, let's dive in, I would like to try this one first because I can tell it's a shrimp one. Let's try it with the lime sauce. Dang. These are tasty. Guys, these are tasty. Dang. Dang. I think this one is just pork. Let's try this one with the red sauce. I'm holding back on my full commentary. The dumplings themselves have this wonderful chew, wonderful sort of squidgy chew to the skins, and then this rich filling, rich meaty filling. But it's got that minced up ginger and garlic and scallion, and we threw in mirin and sake. So it's not like heavy. It's rich but not heavy, which means you can probably just shovel these things in and keep going, because it's not doesn't like The filling is mostly meat, but since it doesn't have that meaty heaviness to it, you can just keep eating these. I only tried two of the sauces. The red sauce is a lovely combination of spicy and smoky. The acidity in it, when I combined it with the dumpling, I couldn't really taste the acidity of it by itself, but I'm sure it is working to balance out. You definitely want acidic sauces with this, so it's a good thing I did acidic sauces for all of these. The green sauce is sharp and limey, but again, the acidity, it's too acidic by itself, but the acidity balances really well with the dumpling. The green one, unfortunately, does not look very appealing. Let's try this one. I'm gonna end up being four of these on camera because I gotta try four sauces. Let's try the weird one, and you can see how it's like a dark green color. But you could just eat these for hours. These are dangerous. You could just eat and eat and eat, eat these things. Interesting. This sauce is the tastiest when I just dip my finger in it and try it by itself. But because what it's giving me when I try it tasted by itself is mostly a savory flavor, it is not the best so far with the dumplings. It's just doubling up on that savory flavor, as opposed to the other ones, which are offering a counterpoint. In both cases, it's acidity, but in this case, it's this bright, citrusy acidity for the green one. And over here, there's a smokiness and a spiciness to it. Let's try the yellow one, and then I will wrap up. But I kind of want to put these sauces in the holes, so the sauce is inside the things. That might be a way to take these. Let's try one more with the yellow sauce. Ooh. That one's weird. Okay, that sauce is weird. Me taste that sauce by itself again. I'm not sure about that one. I'm not sure about that one. It's acidic but fruity. It's a lot sweeter. It's definitely the sweetest one. So taste-wise, these two went weird, and these two sauces go with this. These two sauces went kind of weird and don't really go with this. I think the fruitiness is not, it's not a good pairing with this. And this thing is just another savory sauce with doubling up on the savoriness. So these are both out. Which one's my favorite? I kind of want to combine these two into one sauce and call that my favorite. Because the green one is got this bright citrus acidity to it, whereas the red one has a spiciness to it. But also it has that smoky element. I guess if I had to pick one, it would be the green one. I think a pairing with this, the green one is the tastiest one as a pairing with this. I don't think it needed that mayonnaise that I put in there. I think it would have actually been fine. But taking notes, I could combine the elements of these two without the colors into one sauce. And if we successfully colorize this stuff, I won't have to worry about the sauce's color, which is great because I would hate to, because if you combine these, it's going to be the color of mud. Not going to be good. It's going to be like this guy. It's just going to be mud brown. Yeah, so dumplings, success. I definitely took a little bit of practice, but I think I got a handle on this five petal design. I will attempt to make my own dough in the future and then revisit this concept. I've got good notes from the sauces. I kind of want to. Okay, I'm going to do one more taster. We're going to take one of these little spoons. We're going to take one of the dumplings and we're going to nestle it in the little spoon. And then we're going to pour the sauce on top of it. And then we're going to eat it like a soup dumpling, even though it's not a soup dumpling. Here you go. The red and the green sauces are both very good. I'm worried that I'm just going to polish off this whole plate now. Because these are very tasty. That'd be a lot of food. I'll probably end up stopping before I get through them all. Nope, everybody's fallen off. So I guess we'll raid out before we lose everybody. Who's on right now? LeFay is playing the corn. Oh, LeFay is playing the corn game. We're gonna go raid LeFay. Join me, won't you, in a raid? We're gonna go see LeFay. Friend of the show, LeFay. It's been a minute since we raided over there. She is playing Maze, spelled with an I, which is a corn game. It's about corn. I don't want to spoil anything, so I won't tell you about it, but I have seen this game before, and it's a hoot. I don't know what possessed Lefay to play it, but let's all go bother her and have fun. And I will clean up a bit. I will be there to say hi, but then I'm gonna have to clean up a bit. I will be back definitely on Saturday, possibly later this week, as I have projects and ideas. Suddenly, I've got more ideas and I want to get them out into the real world before I lose them. So, I guess I'll give you a heads up if I'm on Thursday, maybe. Either way, see you when I see you. Thanks for hanging out. Thanks for being here. I appreciate it. And I will catch you next time. Bye.